Actually, the time lapse has been good because it's been a chance to assimilate some of the feelings, and it's time to celebrate the life of Anita. So let's begin with prayer, a prayer of celebration. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister, Anita. We remember her extraordinary gifts of relationship, her ways of compassion, her ways of affirmation, her ways of the spirit, her ways with photography, her ways with wit, her ways with poetry. You told us, let not your hearts be troubled, that in your house are many rooms, and that you have gone to prepare a place for us. We have the assurance of that promise today. We thank you for giving Anita to us to know and to love as a companion in this world. Give us your aid so we may see in death the gate to the new place, the new room, the eternal life. And may we continue our course on earth in kindness until all we are reunited with those who have gone before us through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Leo Pei, and I'm a student here at Augsburg College. At this time, I'd like to have President Frame come up and do the welcome.
Welcome indeed to an event that I think the college has been waiting for, looking forward to, since January, in order that we might, in fact, celebrate the gift that was given us for 10 years as the director, even shaper, of our Pan-African Student Services Initiative in the form of Anita Gay Hawthorne. This memorial has drawn back into our midst a number of people that knew her and worked with her during that period of time. I've met some of them, and it has also attracted the attention, I think, of Natsiki Biko and her son Kozananti, who happened to be here for the sake of a celebration of Stephen Biko's life, which was itself dedicated to a purpose that surely was consistent with Anita's efforts, namely unity, racial unity in particular. This is therefore a wonderful occasion. Its delay, as Anita's husband has pointed out, may have lifted our capacity for joy even higher than had it occurred on the eve of that catastrophic event in January. Thanks for coming. Have a good time.
At this time, Tammy Salarin will bring to us the occasion.
Good afternoon, everyone. We're here to celebrate. We're here to honor. We're here to share. Some of us are gonna cry, some of us are gonna laugh. But most of all, we will remember the giving, living of Anita Gay Hawthorne. We are going to have people share with you stories, testimonies, poetry, and music. This would not only be a dedication to her, but actually an inspiration from her. If you feel like laughing, laugh. If you feel like crying, cry. If you feel like saying amen, say amen. Ms. Hawthorne would say, if you feel like getting comfortable, take off your shoes. So, take off your shoes and get comfortable. Let's remember a person who gives more of herself than anybody I've ever known. Let's remember a true warrior. Thank you.
Next, we shall have a final selection from the band, and they're going to play Joshua at the Battle of Jericho, which was one of Anita's favorite selections from the Band of Augsburg. At this time, we're going to have some community testimonies from Rosa Bogar, Halisi E. Staten, and Mahmoud El Kadi.
Good evening. I'm very fortunate. I came over just to deliver this poem to Anita's husband, and I was told to read this poem. I had the opportunity on September the 18th to stand here and recite this poem in dedication of Anita. She sat right over there. I can see her spirit and feel her spirit right now as I read this poem. The Black Rose. The black rose will never wither away. By rains of life, in our hearts of day. The black rose stands proud and tall. She produces in any soil. The black rose remains priceless and rare. She possesses a beauty no other rose can compare. And that is Anita today. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Halisi Edwards Stadden, and I'm here as the former president of the Association of Black Psychologists. When I was the president of the Black Psychologists, Anita was the vice president. In giving some remarks about Anita, I could say a lot of things. She was my friend. She was my sister. She was one of my coworkers. We spent a great deal of time together. I think what I would say most about Anita was that she was a warrior. Whenever I needed to call on someone for support, whenever I needed someone to join hands with me to work on something, I didn't have to give it a second thought. I would call Anita. Anita was the type of person that she would go the nine yards with me on anything and everything that we worked on. So whenever I joined anything, from the Black Psychologist to the book club, to anything that I was involved in, to ASILI, which was an Institute of African Women, I called Anita. It never failed. Whatever I did, I called Anita. She was just that dependable. When you think about going through this life, how many of you can point to someone that you can call on anytime for anything? I mean, think real hard about that. You can call on that person for anything that you want, anything that you need, and they'll answer that call. That's what Anita was to me, a person I could call on at any time for anything. She loved me. I knew that. I loved her, and she knew that. Thank you very much.
I'm afraid that I'm going to be somewhat redundant because I tried my best to express my sentiments, my love and appreciation for Anita as a person. More importantly, Anita as a champion of trying to make things better. Langston Hughes once wrote a poem. He said that justice is a blind goddess, the thing to which we blacks are wise, her vantage point like festering sores that once perhaps rise. He could have written that for Anita. She was that kind of person, I think unique, who discovered her mission, which is a very important thing. Happens to few people, in the words of Franz Fanon, each generation out of relative obscurity must discover its own mission and either fulfill it or betray it. She fulfilled hers. She understood what it was she was attempting to do. As an African-American person, as a descendant of a slave, as a person who living in a somewhat complex country, calling it a democracy, and realizing that her role was to help create democracy. That's what I think Anita was doing. She was teaching students, those of whom she had contact with, those from her community, to respect themselves and others, and above all, respect the heritage of their people without apologies. That's very human for people to do that. You can't come from nowhere to somewhere, you come from somewhere to somewhere. And that is the way it is, and she was very forthright about that, a very proud African woman who exuded that and was a very compassionate and magnanimous towards other people. She understood it well, that there is a dream in this land with its back against the wall. To save the dream for some, it must be saved for all.
Good afternoon, everybody. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening to you. I'm sorry, we apologize. We're trying to broadcast this live, so if you will tolerate just a little bit of a delay. And Brother Kwangare, thank you very much for holding on. We're trying to get right into the flow of it, okay? So if you'll give us a few moments, and then we'd like to get your introduction on live as well. Thank you. Now. We'll be going on in 46 seconds. Thank you. Mrs. Biko. Brother Kwangare.
Good afternoon, honorable guests. Mrs. Nonsekelelo Ntsiki Biko of Umtata in South Africa was married to Stephen Biko in 1970. They lived in King William's Town, about an hour's drive outside of East London in South Africa. They had two sons and a daughter before imprisonment and torture took the life of Stephen Biko. On Tuesday, September 6, 1977, Stephen Biko was taken by the South African Security Police from the police station in Wilmar to downtown Port Elizabeth. In the Cape Town province of Strand Street stands the San Lam building, which had on the sixth floor special offices rented by the South African police security. Stephen was kept naked, handcuffed, put into iron legs, chained in a grill, and subjected to 22 hours of interrogation, during which he was tortured and beaten. Stephen Biko sustained several blows to the head that caused a fatal brain injury. Stephen Biko lapsed into a coma and died 6 days later in police custody without receiving proper medical attention. Donald Woods, in his book, Biko, states, he was only 30 years when he died, and he had lived in obscurity, silenced from public utterance by banning orders and restricted to a small town, remote from metropolitan areas. He was forbidden to function fully as a political personality, yet in his short lifetime, he influenced the lives and idols of millions of his countrymen, and his death court continues to convulse our nation and reverberate far beyond its boundaries. The movie Cry Freedom is a tribute to the character, charisma, and leadership against apartheid and the cause of freedom that Stephen Biko personified. Mrs. Ntsiki Biko has continued this legacy. She has faced leaders of South Africa's apartheid and challenged the public accounts of her husband's death. Mrs. Biko has brought the court of public opinion to examine the actions of the South African Security Police from 1977 to 1996. In 1996, the final hearings of the South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission were conducted on the amnesty applications of the South African Security Police and implicated in the death of Stephen Biko. Mrs. Biko works as a nurse at a hospital in King William's Town. She continues to be a guiding force for children and are of those who seek truth and justice in the world. Nkosinathi Biko, the eldest son of the couple, works in Johannesburg, and he produces a documentary about his father's life, and we are honored to have them here. We thank the judge and the International Leadership Institution for making this presentation possible, Judge Lujeune Lang. And it is an honor for me, as I stand here, a patriotic Zimbabwean close to South Africa, to fully honor, to realize the essence of our visit by Mrs. Nonsekelelo Ntsiko Biko. And I am gratified and honored to introduce to you. And please welcome, help me welcome Mrs. Nonsekelelo Ntsiki Biko.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. To the pastor, the president of Augsburg College, Dr. William Frame, the vice president, honored guests, staff, students, it is indeed an honor for me and my son, Nkosinathi, to be able to attend this gathering, a very important gathering indeed. It's a fitting tribute to Anita Gay Hawthorne, whose life touched the lives of many people in this community and beyond. I never got the fortune to meet and know Anita, yet it is evident from the spirit that she indeed was an asset, and that the college and the Twin Cities have been dealt a blow by her unfortunate passing. However, there's a thread that passes through and connects people who live a selfless life. And for this reason, I feel I can stand here and speak about this unfortunate experience and its impact. The 1970s were a very important era in South Africa, especially in the African politics, under the leadership of my husband, Stephen Bantu Biko. The Black Consciousness Movement was able to resuscitate a dying spirit of liberation. Community projects based on the notion of reliance began to sprout in various parts of the country, And the notion that black people could do nothing for themselves was not only challenged, but it was shattered. In 1976, we saw in South Africa the most visible form of this revival in the spirit of resistance. Young children took to the streets in protest against the use of Afrikaans as a compulsory medium of instruction in black schools. In response, the South African government set loose an army of police on defenseless children. The result was the Soweto massacre. By 1977, the state had intensified its suppression of the liberation movement. Many were driven to exile, and some, like my husband, Bantu, Stephen Biko, came to meet their death during the period of blatant regard for the value of human life. For South Africa, these incidents, and Steve's death in particular, was very disheartening. He had been viewed by many as an embodiment of hope for the country. From my own experience, I'm here to tell you that the death of people like Steve, Anita Gay Hawthorne, Malcolm X, Dr. King is never easy to deal with. Their role is very significant. The leadership too valuable to lose, yet leaders are leaders because they have the ability to work with people and to infuse their strengths into others. I think this is what Anita also did. It is true that an organization is permeated by and reflect the leadership, and for this reason is equipped to survive such losses. Therefore, seek solace in the fact that Anita Gay Hawthorne shared her life and enriched those around her. Thank you very much.
Mrs. Biko, if you would please come up at this time. On behalf of the Minority Student Services on campus, we'd like to present you with this small token of appreciation. At this time, we're going to move into our faculty testimonies, and we'd like to ask Francine Shikolas, assistant professor from the Social Work Department, and Mary Lou Williams from the Social Work Department to come up at this time.
Good afternoon. I'm Mary Lou Williams. Francine is ill today, and she sends her regrets. But she also sent a brief message. Francine says, Anita was a special and great friend. She could always count on Anita, and that's so true. She spoke of Anita's membership on the diversity committee and her support of social justice. And another thing that Francine said, and I want to talk a little bit about this, is Anita encouraged Francine. When she felt you were doing something that was needed, she would stand behind you and encourage you, no matter how difficult it gets, stay there and hang in there and complete the task. So Francine says she misses Anita, and it would have been very painful for her to be here today, simply because she had gotten her grieving to the place where it wasn't so much to the surface. But she is ill, and she sends her regrets. And I'd like to say something about Anita. It was just pointed out in the spokesman article that Anita, and I knew this, that she went to two black colleges. And the quote from the spokesman that I like is that she's a cultural thoroughbred. And I think that really describes Anita. And the thing that I like so much about that is that I think Augsburg was very, very fortunate in that Anita brought to this campus one of the things that makes black colleges so successful, and that's the role of nurturer. That black colleges not only educate their students, they know that for many, being in a strange atmosphere, being in a society that devalues them, calls for a special kind of care, a special kind of support, and a special kind of nurturing. And she brought that to this campus. When she talked about her children, she always talked about her children. Colleges do not call their students children. You're supposed to grow up when you go to college. But what Anita knew was that the black students on this campus needed to be nurtured and be told on a regular basis they can achieve, they're loved, and they're wanted if they're to stay here and be successful. And I listened to her tell a student who was on his way out the door he was not going to go to Augsburg, he was quitting, he wasn't coming back. I don't care where you go, just go somewhere and get that degree. And I was at his commencement when he got his degree from Howard University. I was proud, and I called Anita and I said, hey, not only did he get the degree, he got it with honors. So she had an impact. But I want to end on this note. When Anita came here, the black men, the black women on campus didn't talk to each other. And she was patient. She had more programs to talk about black male-female relationships. She wrote poems. She got people writing poems. She tried to get me to write a poem. But one day I walked in the college, Senator Christensen Center, and I saw the black men and black women standing in the lobby, laughing and talking. And I said, Anita, it's taken 4 years, but it's paid off. Now, that might not seem very special to some of you, but if you were here during that time when the men and women weren't having any kind of positive relationships on this campus, and you realize the isolation they must have felt when their own people weren't giving them recognition. And Anita, in her own quiet way, she never, ever gave up. Just stayed to the task. She was very generous. She would keep me to the task sometimes. When I'd get lonely and things would look bad, I'd go over and sit down in her office like the students do. And Anita would say, girl, go on back there. You know you're just upset about something. You'll be all right tomorrow. And there'd be a message on my phone the next day, a gift in my mailbox. To say that I miss Anita is an understatement. She was a very, very special person. And I think her family, I thank you for sharing her with us for so long.
Next, we're going to have a singing duet from Jeanette Whitted and April Jennings, who are also students from Augsburg College.
Thank you. going to lead. All I know is where we've been and what we've been through. And if it gets us to tomorrow, I hope it's worth the pain. It's so hard to say goodbye to yesterday. And I'll take with me the memories to be my sunshine.
Mrs. Biko, we're not done with you yet. We still have a couple gifts for you. And Tim Chaya Shalane is gonna do that. Is Tammy here yet?
Okay, on behalf of the Pan-African Student Union here at Augsburg, we would like to give this to Mrs. Biko and her son.
Okay, next on our program, we are going to have staff testimonies brought to us by Lee Hu Benson, Director of Pan-Asian Student Services, Eloisa Chavez, Director of Hispanic Latino Student Services, Cindy Peterson, the Director of American Indian Student Services, and Nancy Gibo, Counselor, Counseling and Health Promotions Women's Group.
I'm a little nervous, and that's why I wrote this up. Students, friends, colleagues, honored guests, and family members of our dear and departed Anita, a very good afternoon to all of you. As we gather on this very fine sunny day to remember Anita and to carry on her legacy, let us not mourn too morosely, but remember the strength that she showed, especially during her darkest days, so that we too may learn from her example of how to live and see life on its sunny side. Anita worked hard and lived well, but never once complained when things were not too swell. It seemed that Anita always chose to think that there was sunshine on the other side of the foggy mountain that she was climbing. And as she climbed, she planted seeds of hope and cultivated those with loving care. The many former students whom worked with Anita and with whom she had so carefully nurtured to be strong and productive world citizens are testimonies to her work to her work and life of faith, caring, and commitment to the causes that are larger than herself, despite the onerous circumstances that Anita sometimes faced. Anita worked her magic of loving kindness among students, colleagues, and friends. She believed in the better of each of us, and we should be mindful of her belief in us as we gather to remember her. Anita treasured her students and sought the best for their welfare. I witnessed with great admiration the networks of support among former and current students that she had created for her current students. To her students, Anita was counselor, mentor, advocate, friend, and oftentimes mother. And she played those roles joyfully and faithfully, and I must add, without complaint. To her many colleagues, Anita was a steadfast and trusted professional who could always be counted on for a refreshing perspective. There are many colleagues who I know will miss Anita's way of telling the hard truth with words spoken softly and elegantly in the spirit of the poet that she was. To her countless friends, Anita gave her all, even when the giving was sometimes physically unbearable. Many of us have learned useful lessons about the durability of the human spirit and the strength of a life mission from Anita. As a colleague who was later honored with her friendship, I cherish Anita's vision, strength, grace, and courage, and these are the gifts I shall remember her by. In closing, I'd like to honor Anita with the words of the great Lebanese poet Khalil Gibran, who wrote about death with these words: "Only when you drink from the river of silence shall you indeed sing. And when you have reached the mountaintop, then you shall begin to climb. And when the earth shall claim your limbs, then shall you truly dance." I'll miss Anita greatly, and I hope we will do her legacy justice. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I didn't write anything. I didn't prepare anything. I'm a little bit sick right now with a cold, so you bear with my voice. But I thought that all of us here at Augsburg, when we talked about Anita, we just have to see her students. And to see her students, to see and to hear what they have to say is the greatest testimony of Anita's work, of Anita's legacy here at Augsburg. As a colleague, I learned a lot from Anita. Anita was the kind of person that she didn't preach at you, she didn't lecture you, she just role model. And I really miss that. And as you remember the way Anita spoke, she didn't ever use fancy words. She was so simple talking, which was good for me. Perfectly understood everything she was saying. But she, every word she said carries a lot of weight. Everything she said, it always went really beyond what we could ever expect it. Last September, here at Augsburg, we celebrated her 10th anniversary of service. And I had the fortune to be able to be here in that evening. And she said, in the middle of the row, back there, she didn't sit in front like, hey, I'm being honored today or something. She was just watching like she was one of the guests. And she was enjoying like, you remember? Yeah. A lot of the people who are here today and a lot of community members remember that day. A lot of the alums remember that evening. It was a beautiful, beautiful evening. And there was that evening when I really got to appreciate Anita even more than I did before, because I started listening to all of the things that people have to say, not just her students, but people from her community, from professional associations, and I realized how much well connected Anita was with her community, and I really appreciate that too. And that was something else that I also admire from Anita, the way that she gave herself not only to the Augsburg community, but to the outside community. So many things I have to say about Anita without even thinking. I love when Mary Lou talked about the nurturing part, because that's really what makes her so unique. And I hope that we can all do it here at Augsburg without feeling ashamed of that kind of things that we have to give to our students, the nurturing piece that I really learned that from Anita too. She was caring, she was passionate, but she was really simple in the ways, and she enjoyed simple things. I remember that I gave her for her 10th anniversary some candies, and she called me the next day, "Oh, those are the best candies, I love them, those are my favorite candies." And I didn't know that. And of course, I don't think she was telling me the truth. But that was Anita was so grateful, so thankful. For Christmas party, I remember again, we share a gift, and I gave her a black bag. Maybe her husband is using it right now. But, well, it was for both women and men. It's kind of a traveling bag. So she called me like 2 weeks later, and she said, "Eloisa, that was the best Christmas present I ever got in my life. I love it. I'm going to use it a lot." So that was Anita. And I really missed Anita, and I really miss her, really her way to see things. She was looking at things from a very different perspective, very relaxed. "Oh, I don't care. That's all right. It doesn't matter, you know." So, and I'm very hyper, and I'm very kind of passionate about things, but she was passionate on a very different way. So I think that she kind of, I could learn from her from that level of passionate as well. So I could stay here forever talking about Anita, but I'm gonna let my colleagues to keep saying more things, which might be redundant, but I think we never run out of things to say about Anita. So thank you for being here, and we're missing Anita, but I know she's having a great time. She's laughing, she's content, and she's just saying, "Hey, look at the wonderful things they're saying about me." So enjoy, and I'm gonna let my people, and thank you to her family, and especially to her husband, for sharing Anita with us.
This reminds me, we're all different sizes, heights. I'm Cindy Peterson. I'm the director of the American Indian Student Services Program at Augsburg, and I had the privilege of sharing space with Anita over the last few years. Our two programs were housed together in the Little Red Brick House at 620 21st Avenue South. I found in Anita a kindred spirit. It appeared as though we had similar life values. We share an educational background in psychology. We share a love of plants and a similar philosophy of providing nurturing framework within which students can grow. I remember when Anita first moved into the little house. She would greet visitors at the door like a little automaton or a wind-up doll. "Hello, my name is Anita Gay. Welcome to the Office of Pan-African Student Services and American Indian Support Program. We are so glad you came to visit us today. Can I get you some water?" I used to think that was just Anita being silly. I've since come to see that was her way of poking fun at the situation and also of creating a place for herself and her program in our territory. I remember being in meetings with Anita when she was advocating providing campus-wide support for her students and for all students of color. I remember her saying, "Terstig's parents want the same thing for their child as Sholanda's parents want for their child. And those things are quality education and opportunities to develop as individuals and become contributing members of the community." She knew a good line when she said it. We heard that one often. Her perspective helped others to consider things a bit differently than what they were used to. I remember Anita as diplomat, witnessing her in a difficult situation with a difficult colleague who was used to being intimidating and getting her own way. I was amazed at how Anita kept that conversation focused by continually asking the single most relevant question until the other woman could no longer dodge the answer. I remember thinking, I want to take lessons from this lady. She's something. I remember a playful Anita. In the summer, when the windows and doors of our building were open, she'd be coming back from the big house, as she affectionately called the Christensen Center. Coming up the sidewalk, she'd holler, Cindy, can you come out and play? I remember feeling embarrassed at first and shouting, no. But she didn't give up, and soon I found myself entering into the game. Okay, what do you want to do? Let's play jacks, she'd say, and that'd be it. Sometime that exchange would engage us in further conversation, but often she'd just head to her office, and I'd continue with what I had been doing. I remember Anita as mentor in my eavesdropping on her interactions with students on the other side of the building. And I remember thinking, this lady knows what support is. It's about providing place and time for students to be. Sometimes she confronted, sometimes she comforted, sometimes she took students to task, sometimes she challenged. Always, always, she did it with love. I never knew her to do anything that was not in students' best interest or on behalf of students. You know, I've never heard any of her students call her Anita. It was always Ms. Anita or Ms. Hawthorne. She was respected. I remember Anita of a positive attitude. You knew she had to be suffering physically, yet her spirit was strong and so positive, so forward-looking. I don't remember ever hearing her complain. I just started reading a book called The Fourfold Way, Walking the Paths of Warrior, Teacher, Healer, and Visionary by Angelus Arian. I'd like to share some excerpts from the section on the Way of the Warrior because I think it fits into our program today. Indigenous societies throughout the world connect to the process of empowerment through the mythic theme and archetypal expression of the warrior. Throughout history, men and women who have explored the way of the warrior have been called leaders, protectors, sorcerers, adventurers, and explorers. In contemporary Western society, becoming an effective leader in any field of endeavor means developing the inner warrior. The principle that guides the warrior is showing up and choosing to be present. The developed warrior shows honor and respect for all things, employs judicious communication, sets limits and boundaries, is responsible and disciplined, demonstrates right use of power, and understands the three universal powers. And now I'd like to share just a brief little excerpt from the right use of power section in this same chapter. The challenge of every warrior and leader is the right use of power. Native peoples of the American continents use the words power and medicine synonymously. If we fully express who we are said to be full of power and expressing our medicine. Power is a human resource that is often equated with the use of energy or the empowerment of self and others. When we demonstrate our power, no one can tell us what can't be done. We are freed from patterns of self-diminishment and are less likely to accept other people's perceptions of what we can and cannot do. In mythological terms, the problematic suggestions that we give ourselves and others are known as spells, magical incantations that govern our behavior. Common spells include the words, I can't, I wish I would have, someday I will, and if only. Remember Anita's last talk in chapel? We all had buttons that said things like, I am, I can, I am a star. She inspired others. The tiny pin, I have a visual aid and you can't see it because it's about this big, I'm wearing today is called a blessing pin. I bought it for Anita for her birthday when I was visiting my brother over Christmas this past December. The term blessing pin caught my attention initially. The picture on the pin is a sprig of berries from the hawthorn. This is what the placard said. The hawthorn is an ancient symbol of hope. It is said that those who wear it will carry a bright and hopeful heart into life wherever they may go. In loving memory of Anita. As a staff member in the Division of Student Affairs with Anita, for 10 years, she and I found many opportunities to collaborate. And one of our collaborations was the Touch Program, which I hope somebody remembers. We had a lot of fun doing it. And another collaboration was the women's group, which we ran together for 4 years. And I'm going to talk about that group today, but I know it doesn't only talk about the women's group, it talks about all the students that I think that she touched. So, in the women's group, we came together. It was a place to talk about our lives. It was a holding place, a talking circle, a being place, a human place, a growing place, a woman's place, where just being yourself was the prerequisite, where friendships were born. It was a comfort and an acceptance zone, where others wanted to know you. Sometimes the men upstairs would say, well, what do they talk about down there? We invited them sometimes when we had food. Well, we talked about the women we admired. We talked about relationships and dreams and families and children and sisterhood and men, affectionately referred to in the group as hombres. We talked about husbands, we talked about mothers and grandmothers and hurts and growing pains. And we celebrated birthdays, weddings, children, graduations. We laughed a lot, and we cried too. And it was a place where Anita read her poetry to us sometimes. I took some time to recontact some of the women in the group and talk to some of the women here today about Anita. And this is what they had to say. She gave strength to other women. She had courage and inspiration. She was a visionary. She had the ability to keep things in perspective. She always had the right words to say, and she knew what others needed to hear. Yet, she could tell it like it is. She had good ideas. And she had impeccable timing. And she would just show up outside the group just when you most needed her. She taught us to be proud of who we are and say your name and say who you are with confidence. The women's group began each meeting with each of us sharing a blessing and a bummer in our lives since we last met. So as for the blessings, in the women's group, simply knowing Anita was a blessing, her guidance, her insistence on us thinking of ourselves positively, her nudge to face what may be difficult to reach or to see in our own lives, crossing the bridges she helped build between people from different races and life circumstances, being touched by her exuberance for life and the creative fires in her soul. As for bummers, it's the missing and the loneliness that creeps in. One special student here today said to me, "Don't make me cry." Well, I am sure that the tears of celebration today and the tears of sadness will only fall on the seeds that she's planted here. And they will surely bloom. As for me, in my garden at home, I've had these little blue flowers talking to me for weeks. They're forget-me-nots. Anita loved the arts. She was always saying, we need to make a play, we need to write a poem, we need to.
And so, at Augsburg now, we are writing a play, and it's about the lives of students here, about faculty, about staff. It's about this college. The name of the play is The Ties That Bind, and the title came from Francine Chocolis in a speech she gave many years ago. In the last week of Anita's life with us, she met with the playwright, the scriptwriter, for hours and poured out the stories that she wanted to be known about her life. So I would like to invite you to the play this fall. The production will be dedicated to the life of Anita, and we hope that you can come. As a gift to you, we have some poems for you, and there's so many poems of Anita's, but we made some poems that will be on a table that we'd like you to take, the ones that you would like. And this is from the women's group, this is from the students and Pan-African students. This is from all of us. And I'd like to close with final words from Anita's poem. A woman is a woman, and I think it surely speaks of her. A woman is a woman is a woman, finding the beauty of real beauty a little bit at a time. With love.
Now we're going to have Mr. Albert McClure come up for a poetry dedication.
And I'm an old friend and a poetic friend of Anita's. We seem to have the same spirit, and sometimes she'd call me and say, Al, I've got a poem I want you to listen to. And she'd read it. And then I'd say, oh, just a moment, I have an answer to that one. And so I'd read her a poem, and that's the way it's been all of our friendship. And when she came over here, she asked me to come over with her when they had poetry. She said, because we need a man over there to tell the men how to write love stories, love poems. And I became noted as a romantic poet. And I would like to share several things with you. The first one is because she always lived for dreams, and she tried to encourage everybody to have dreams. And so this one is called The Dream Merchant. Tell me your dreams, for I am the dream catcher. I am the net that holds your breath, your dreams, until they come true. Tell me your wants, for I am the want catcher. I turn wants into dreams, and then dreams into fulfillment. Tell me your dreams. I am the keeper of dreams. I am the dream catcher. Yeah. Now, when we lost Anita, I have a poem called Goodbye to a Friend, which I wrote when my buddy died. That was some time ago, but it's as apropos today as it was then. And it goes, goodbye to a friend. It's hard no matter how I try not to shed a tear at this goodbye. Of those I've met, there are a few I'm glad I met, glad I knew. And since Anita was one of that kind, out of sight will not be out of mind. Thank you.
Next, we'll have a selection by Mr. Pan-Africa, 1995, and recording artist Darren, AKA Poppy Baker.
It is wonderful, wonderful to be here. I first met Anita in 1994, 93 at the Pan-African Conference. I was a student at Morehead State University, and there was kind of a rivalry going on for the title of the Pan-African Conference. But I brushed into Anita a couple times, and every time I saw her, she always had just a couple words of encouragement that were really cool. She was not very pushy, very sassy, and very very witty. But one thing I noticed about Anita is she's a woman of principle and a woman of kindness and a woman that stood by herself and believed in who she was. The title of the song is called Mama. And everything that's going on here today, everything that people are saying, is basically saying that she was a nurturer and she was a mother. And to her mother, I think it's to your credit and to your family's credit that you put forth such a beautiful person that's a mother to everybody. So you can start it. Yes, sir. And going out to Anita, wherever she is right now in her journey, and all the wonderful things that the Lord has taken her through right now, and all the things that are being revealed to her, and the goodness that she's understanding. Let's go out to her mama. I remember the Sunday mornings waking up to your love and dedication. The whole family bowing our heads to say grace. And no one in this world has done so much for us. A scrubbing floors to give us more. We just can't thank you enough. In the beginning, you were instilling the beautiful things that makes us winners. I'm glad we listen. It keeps us from straying from my mission to love and find peace of mind. To honor the inner man and always stand by your clan. Thank you, Mama. Mama, you the best mama, anyone could have, yes sir, cause mama, you the best mama. Anita's gave so much to us. Mama, you the best mama, yeah, anyone could have, yes sir, cause mama, you the best mama. You've been so good to us. Forsaking the superficial nonsense that plagued this life. Our life is your life because you brought us up right. I see at times we just couldn't understand. It seems that you were mad, but mama, you had a plan. You was making us into soldiers, upright human beings, on your knees pleading, good Lord, bless my children. A Sunday school, you've got to follow the rules. I love your neighbors as yourself and love yourself like no one else. A lesson that you were stressing, trying to save us from complications. Listen to your elders, never believe that you're your failure. See, mama's love brought us through many a hard times. On cloudy days, she was our sunshine. Thank you, mama, cause mama, you're the best mama anyone could have. Yes, mama, you the best mama. You've been so good to us. Mama, you the best mama that anyone could have. Mama, you the best mama. Yes, she's been so good to us. And now we're all grown up, trying to make it in this life, a pushing towards the future, fast forward, and all of the wonderful times, and all of the terrible times, all fall into line, when we think about the past, and we used to ask, mama, how's it gonna be, and you say, everything gonna be alright, everything gonna be just fine, sweetheart of mine, just keep your head to the sky, share the love, remain devoted, you said it, you lived it, and in our hearts you wrote it, mama, you the best mama, yes sir. Anyone could have, and you nurtured us. Mama, you're the best mama. You've been so good to us all day. Mama, you're the best mama. Anyone could have all day. Mama, you're the best mama. You've been so good to us. In keeping with the love right now, we just like to tell Anita we still love her, and we will always love her. A person still exists no matter where they are, in the flesh or in the spirit. And if you love her, she loves you. Remember the lessons, remember the experiences, because that's what she wants you to take from everything that she's ever given to you. Thanks to Augsburg College, thanks to the Pan-African students, and thanks to the Creator for such a beautiful person. Thank you.
Next, we're going to have an alumni come up, Keith Allen, for another portrait dedication.
Hello. With a smile. I here to bring cheers. There's no reason for a sad face, because I wouldn't do this if I saw sad faces out here today. But it's nice to see you guys here with smiles on your faces. A warrior still stands. With faith and love as a breastplate, hope of salvation as a helmet, and a Bible in the hand, clap for the warrior that still stands. A warrior falls to his knees and pray, thanking God their life is not the same as they praise his holy name. Greed, jealousy, lust, nope, no more, in God who a warrior trusts. A warrior cares more for your spirit than the friendship, because your spirit was promised eternal life, not the friendship on this earth. Will not turn around, will not look back on a spiritual fast, no time for a snack. A warrior will never stand alone, but a warrior will never stand alone, because a warrior was promised. A warrior believes they can fly. A warrior believes they can touch the sky. A warrior walks by faith and not by sight, till early morning to late at night. Didn't I tell you I'll fly away? Didn't I tell you I'll fly away? This is a warrior's song. This is a warrior's story that will be sung all the days long. A warrior. A true warrior, not dying by the sinner's life, but living a life more like Jesus. A warrior that can't be stopped. A warrior that has no weapons that ever will form against him or her. No evil shall overtake a warrior. It makes you say, nah, 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 nah. A no-limit warrior. Do you remember those two questions? Was she sick? Is she dead? Now think about it. With faith and love as a breastplate and hope of salvation as a helmet, warriors don't die, they multiply. Amen.
At this time, we will have alumni testimonies brought to us by Chad Jackson, class of 1997, Nuru Andriantiana, class of 1991, Jean-Noel Kwame, class of 1995, Abeko Abeyenga, class of 1991, and Tanya Tensley, class of 1989.
I just want to know who all of us up here wants to follow that up. This has been a beautiful day. This has really been a beautiful day. I'm really glad to be here. I'd like to give an honor to God for allowing me to be on this such a beautiful day, to honor such a beautiful person. I'm reminded of a phone call that I got about two, maybe 3 weeks ago. Brother Joe called me up at my work, and he left voicemail. I wasn't there at the time, and if anybody knows how Brother Joe talks, he just kind of, you know, especially when he's got a real thought on his mind, he just gives it to you, and he's... Chad, this is Brother Joe, you know, Office of Penn Avenue Student Services. We got this thing coming up for Miss Anita. I know you want to say a couple words. I'll highlight your piece. I was like, boop. You know, I had to play it again. You know, heart kind of stopped for a minute. Boop. I had to play it again. And I was like, man, all right. You know, so he said, oh, he did throw in there something about 2 minutes, too. But I got to thinking. I was like, what am I going to say? You know, I probably went through the same mental thoughts and processes that everybody else that's had the gracious opportunity to speak up here today, and I was like, what am I gonna say? And last night I was laying in bed, and it just came to me what I was going to talk about, and it was gonna come from the heart. But I remember in my 4 years here at Augsburg, two of those years being president of the Pan-African Student Union, Miss Anita, being over at the office a lot, always used to say to me when I come up and speak, because I never came up with anything in my hand, or I never, you know, gave much thought, and a lot of times maybe put my foot in my behind, you know, but I said what I had to say, and anybody that know me knows I did it well. And if you can look at me right now, I don't have any notes, and I don't have, you know, anything in my hand. Everything's coming from the heart. But one thing she would always say to me, she'd say, baby,
She goes, "Now, you know what you got to say, but you need to slow down and write it down and get you a quote." She goes, "Speakers are so good when they got quotes." Well, I don't have any notes, but I do got a quote today, and a quote that kind of sums up Miss Anita and what she's meant to me, how I try to live my life now. And I think it's indicative of everyone in this room and the people that are here, how they live their life. And it's a quote by Jackie Robinson. He said, "A life is not important unless it has an impact on others." And I think that Jackie said it, but obviously Miss Anita lived it, as did Mr. Robinson. And I think that's just kind of sums up this day, her life and all of our lives in here. If everyone looks around this room right now, and you take a glance to your right and you take a glance to your left, you see the impact. You see the ages. We have young children in here. You know, we have elderly in here. We've got people, you know, of African descent. We got people of African American. We have Europeans. We have, you know, representatives of from South America continents. We were blessed with Mrs. Biko's presence some time ago. So her impact is not only felt in this Twin Cities here on this campus, but it is felt across seas, across oceans, spanning continents. And I think that's just a testament to a wonderful woman. And I am fortunate enough and blessed to have known her for the time that I have. And I love her and I miss her to every day. That quote is on my screensaver at work, and there's not a day that goes by when I think about her and think about my role, not only as an African-American male, but as a citizen here. So I thank all of you for coming out. Miss Anita was definitely a true warrior, and now that she has gone, it is up to us to be her soldiers and continue her passion, continue her vision, and not only on this campus, but widespread. Thank you for your time, and have a great day.
Good afternoon. My name is Jean-Noël Kwame, class of 95. Among all, I was Anita, a student worker. I was a student, and most of all, I was also one of his sons. Some of the stuff we did was Anita took us basically all over the community, the Augsburg community, and also the outside community. As a foreign student also, Anita was the greatest support I could ever had here at Augsburg, as I was struggling to accomplish my education. And what I will remember about Anita was all the little stuff she used to do as a student worker over the summer. I remember she used to bring me lunch every day. She used to treat me for my birthday. She used to send me notes, even send postcard to my mom and dad back home, telling them how I was doing in school and all that stuff. So it was all those little stuff she did that really touched me. And also as an alum, she was always in touch with me, calling me at work, sending me emails, keeping in touch basically. So I was very blessed to have a person like Anita in my life, you know, as I was moving on. And I loved her so much, and I'm gonna miss her. Thank you.
My name is Adbeko Adbenyiga, and I'm happy to be back at Augsburg, seeing all my professors and everybody. I'm one of the fortunate ones Anita nurtured. I still have her last emails on my computer. 3 days before she left this earth. As Jean-Noël said, she kept in touch with all the alumni. She followed me all through South Carolina to Michigan, made sure I was in line. Baker, what's new with you? Okay, Mrs. Hawthorne, da-da-da-da. Okay, what's new with you? I'm fine, just make sure that you do what you have to do. And that means pushing us higher and higher. And I'm proud to tell you that I made a promise to Anita this January, and I fulfilled it. I told her I would get my higher degree, and I made it. That's my dedication to Anita. Mm-hmm. When I heard she was no more, I told myself, what's the use? Oh, then somebody said, well, if you made a promise to her and you really love her, then you have to do it. So I said, yeah. If I can, I want to talk about Anita, we'll go on and on and on. But one thing that she did that I always remember is a sibling rivalry that Nuru and I had. Not a negative rivalry, but she was able to keep that sibling thing, talking about a mama. She was a mama to some of us coming far away from Africa. And we always remember her for all the positive things she did for us. And I hope all of us can keep that legacy by staying together, loving each other, irrespective of race, color, sex, or gender. Thank you.
Hi, good evening. I'm Tanya Tinsley, and I'm very blessed and happy that I could arrive from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania for Anita's memorial. I had just moved to Pittsburgh in January and was not able to attend the funeral. But after when I was flying here, I was trying to figure out what I was going to say, and the man next to me on the plane asked me, are you a Christian? And I said, yes, I am. He said, so am I. Go up there and speak from what's within your heart. Anita was a friend, a motivator, a mother, a sister, and a mentor. She knew where I came from, what I've been through, and where I'm going. I started here at Augsburg as a student athlete in 1985. Yes, it's supposed to be a student athlete, but I had my priorities backwards. I was an athlete student, and that was reflective of my grade point average my first year, my study habits, my time management. I also had some financial obligations that I didn't think I would be able to take care of. So I had to take off a semester from school. Anita called me right when she was getting ready to start and said, I see your name on this list, but you're not enrolled. What's the problem? And I said, well, I kind of messed up my first year, and I had my priorities wrong, and I just don't know if I'm going to be able to make it financially. She says, you know, you need to get your priorities together. Life isn't about basketball. When basketball is all and over, you need to have an education. I got back into school. She knew what I've been through. As a student here, she helped me, she pushed me, she motivated me. I was still able to graduate in 4 years. She pushed me to also realize who I am and that I have inner beauty and that I can go out and give to others. She thought that I should run for the 1989 Miss Black Minnesota pageant. I was like, what, Anita? Me? I'm an athlete, former athlete. I don't, you know, we all have those stereotypes of what pageants are. And she says, no, Tanya, it's about what you have inside. I said, but Anita, I don't have any talent. Write a poem, get up there on the stage, read it, recite it. I said, only with your help, Anita. We wrote a poem together called Come On Up to the 90s Black Woman. That poem has more significance to me now than it did then, and I'll share that with you at the end. Anita and I also had the opportunity to work together. I worked here at Augsburg. And we recruited students, we helped with retaining them here on campus, and I gave back to the students the same thing I received from her on campus. She helped me to build and solidify what my philosophy is about education. And I'm utilizing that now in my work as an academic coordinator. Previously, I was at Iowa, and now I'm at the University of Pittsburgh working with student athletes, getting them to understand it's not only about athletics. Anita knew where I was going. When I was with Iowa last November, I had the opportunity to travel with the women's swim team, and they were swimming against the University of Minnesota. I had been contemplating whether or not I was going to take the position at Pittsburgh for a couple months. I met with her on Friday before Thanksgiving. I wanted to make a decision by Thanksgiving. I went over to Anita's office. She was on her way out. She had just been finished meeting with Bobby Joe. She was on her way out, so I rode with her in the car. She was giving me a ride back to the pool at the University of Minnesota, and I was telling her about my opportunity, and she said, go. You need to go. You need to grow. I said, you know what, Anita, you've really helped me. We talked. I said, I wouldn't be in this position without you because I feel like my counseling style is reflective of what you've done for us here at Augsburg. She knew. I went to Pittsburgh in January. So all I can say is thank you, Anita. Thank you to her family for bringing her here to Augsburg to touch our lives, touch my life. She also got me to understand, and I think a number of students, that we have dreams and we can achieve our dreams. My skit was about the stereotypes that women go through and how we have overcome those stereotypes. As I mentioned, it was titled Coming Up to the 90s. But I've kind of changed it a little bit and changed the end of it. I'm only going to do the end of it to represent today. Come on up to the 90s, black woman. Get with the 90s, black woman. Come on up to the 21st century, black woman. Let's go to the moon. The moon. The moon. Thank you. Thank you, Anita.
Good afternoon. I don't have much to say. I think everybody has said everything I wanted to share about Ms. Hawthorne. It's kind of hard for my sister and I particularly to talk about her because she was our neighbor. We live right on 616 21st Avenue South, which is right next door to her office. My sister and I share the upstairs floor. So one way I would know whether Ms. Hawthorne was in or not was to just look outside my window, and if I saw her Volvo, she was in. And if it wasn't there, then I knew I'd have to call her to make sure she was okay. Ms. Hawthorne practically raised me. I've known her for 11 years, and I came here as a freshman in 87. So she is a great influence in my life. One of the hardest things for me to do is to not be able to run into her office, sometimes barefoot. I just run down from my house and I run into her office if I had something to ask her, or to tell her if I was excited about a phone call or anything that I wanted to share with her. And it's hard to not be able to do that anymore. I still find myself saying, well, I'll think about it and I'll ask Ms. Hawthorne what she thinks. Then I have to stop a minute and I say, oh, I can't really do that, not in person anyways. I still dream about her. One time I remembered, because I became ill right after she passed away, and then I remembered she appeared to me in a dream where she was caressing my feet and she was saying everything will be okay. One of the things that I just wanted to share, kind of underscoring what my fellow alums have talked about, how she keeps in touch with us. And when I went to Mankato State for my master's, she practically was there with me. During one summer, I called her and I was complaining about how I didn't have any money for summer school and whining as usual. And she didn't really say anything. She just said, mm-hmm, as she always does. And I was looking for words of encouragement, and she didn't have any for me at that time. But then 2 days later, I received something in the mail, and it was a scrap paper, something she was probably ready to toss in her wastebasket. But she wrote across it, kind of in a hurry, but very provocative words. And she said, Dear Nuru, everything will be okay. God continues to bless us. Another summer without you. Life is good. M. Anita Hawthorne. And the date. I still have that scrap paper today, and I framed it, actually. And I keep looking at it whenever I miss her. But one of the most important things that she's given me, and I keep with me. The last thing I remember was just in December, 97. I went to her office. A friend of, mutual friend of ours had come from South Africa to visit, and so I brought him to her office to greet her and to visit with her again. And she said, I have a Christmas present for you. And that was kind of scary for me because Ms. Hawthorne never gave me a Christmas present in those 11 years. And I was really shocked why she gave me one last Christmas. And I'm thinking that she must have known her time was coming. And I was really surprised when she gave, and it was a very beautiful brown, kind of a velvet jacket, sports coat. And she said, this is what you wear when you get your first job. And I looked at the size, and it was a size 6. and I said, Miss Hawthorne, I can't wear this. I'm not a size 6. And she goes, that'll fit you. And of course, I'm always arguing with her. I said, no, it won't. She said, well, try it on. So I tried it on, and it fit. And I said, how did you know it would fit? She goes, well, I've been watching you. I've seen how you've been losing weight, she said. I know your size. And that really shocked me because the only person who knows specifics about me is my mother, my birth mother. And it made me realize that, as always, Ms. Hawthorne was always the other mother that I had. She could just look at you and kind of figure out what would be good for you, what's, you know, where you're going in life and things like that. I rejoice in her memory because she's a wonderful role model. And Professor Okatia and I talked once, and I told him how painful it is losing her. And he said, you're blessed for knowing her. Imagine about those people who didn't, and how much happier they would have been. I thank Augsburg for bringing her here. My experience as an international student was definitely enriched because of her. And she is someone I'll always carry with me. My favorite poem she wrote, very simple, very sweet, and to the point. My love for you is more than reality. It's loving you more than me. And she reflected that in her life. Thank you.
At this time, we're going to have another musical selection by Lavorio Salone and Boyd Kohler.
My hands and sing glory. to the Son of God. Oh, glory to the Son of God. And as I entered the gates of that city, my loved ones all knew me well. They took me down the streets of heaven, where the scenes too many to tell. Talked with Mark and Timothy. Then I said, Timothy, I want to see Jesus, 'cause he's the one who died for me. Then I bowed on my knees and cried, holy. I cried, holy, thou art holy. I clapped my hands and sang, glory, glory.
Thank you for that selection. Next, we will have our student testimonies. I'm sorry, we will have some poems that were written by Ms. Hawthorne, and they will be given to us by Tina Jackson, class of 1992, and Trina Bolden. I'm sorry, and Josephine Ballinger as well.
I'm just a black woman, moving and grooving. I'm just a black woman, still trying to do a little bit of proving. I'm just a black woman trying to find my way. I'm just a black woman who can still kneel and pray. I'm just a black woman standing tall. I'm just a black woman knowing without my black man I'll fall. I'm just a black woman, some say I'm too cold. I'm just a black woman who is truly strong, proud, and bold. Good afternoon, y'all. Nita taught me that. Before I do this poem, and I just want to thank Joe for giving me this poem. This is just so appropriate for me. I feel like I was her special child, and I guess we were all so special, but she just touched my life in such a powerful way. I know if she wouldn't have been in my life, I wouldn't have made it through so much. I lost my mom when I was here on campus, and Anita helped me so much. But I know that God put her in my life to keep me going and keep me pushing forward. So
This goes out to Anita. Ain't that loving me? You served me breakfast in bed. Your lap held on my head. Ain't that loving me? You washed up all my dishes. You provided my every wishes. Ain't that loving me? You changed the oil in my car and drove me ever so far. Ain't that loving me? You had the meals waiting on the table and bought me silly blouses when you were able. Ain't that loving me? You gave me flowers, candy, and cards. You stuck with me when times were hard. Ain't that loving me? You listened to my love rhymes. Most of all, gave me your precious time. Yeah, ain't that loving me? M. Anita Gay, Hawthorne.
The poem that I had to read was just read by Tina. So instead of being redundant, I'm just going to give my personal testimony of what Anita meant to me. My connection with Anita was through poetry, and we shared our poetry together in that little brick house. And I just regret that I knew her so little. She really pushed me to write and to present my poetry at the several functions that she hosted on campus, and I'm so thankful to her for giving me that courage to do that. I've never read my poetry out loud until she made me. So I'm very grateful to have known her. Thank you.
A woman is a woman. A woman, if she is a woman, if she is a woman. She is joy and laughter. Touch her and feel beauty. Know her and seek truth. The giving, living, and forgiving a woman is. To soothe her, groove her, move her, reach out to her. A woman is a woman is a woman. Evolved, revolved, involved with time. Changing sun rays like a rainbow. Is a woman, if she is. A woman of all centuries. A woman of today. A woman of tomorrow beyond. A woman is. Though the sounds she hears are new, and yet are not all her own. For a woman is survival and strength. She is the universe, and her dreams are her only boundaries. A woman is a woman is a woman. She is beyond the beauty of being. She is beyond the waiting smile. She is beyond motherhood, wifehood, womanhood. She is personhood, peoplehood, above all, individualhood. A woman is a woman is a woman. Finding the beauty, a real beauty, a little bit at a time. M. Anita Gay Hawthorne. Thank you.
Brother Joe just handed me a poem to read. I want to be able to sleep till I get up, go to lunch whenever, and eat breakfast at midnight. I want to smell fresh coffee and roses, and that favorite fragrance of mine mingling with that, one of yours that drives me wild. I want to walk barefoot through cut grass where the dew has fallen, and then feel hot sand ooze between my toes. I want to see the oceans, east, coast, and west. I want to hug more and say I love you without feeling uncomfortable. I want to bounce babies, maybe even mine. I want to live more adventurously, be more daring, more caring, giving, more forgiving, a little less jealous, and a little more secure. I want to enjoy more sunsets and not mind getting up to see the sunrise and to always have God at the center of my life. I want to play the piano, harp, violin, bass string. I want to draw and sculpt and paint. I want to dance and sing. I want to know everything and understand most. I want to listen more carefully and talk less. I want to cook good basic foods. I want to drink Orgenina and keep writing poems that I may share with you one day. I want to be healthy and happy. Oh, how heavenly. I want to be just me, Miss Anita Gay Hawthorne.
Now we're gonna have the Excelsior Choir come up and sing a song. For those of you who don't know, the Excelsior Choir is a group of wonderful singers here in the Twin Cities that Anita helped put together. So just relax and enjoy their performance.
Oh, hello. Hello. As he stated, we are the Excelsior Choral Ensemble. We're gonna do a song today, which was one of Anita's favorite songs. It's called My Hope is Built on Nothing Less than Jesus' Blood and Righteousness. We also would like to say that on May 15th is going to be the release date for the choir's second album. And this particular album is dedicated to M. Anita Gay Hawthorne.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I
dare not trust
the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name.
When he shall come
when trumpets sound, oh, may I then in him be found.
My
hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness.
boy, was that great or what? What y'all think? Now I'm gonna have some students come up and give their testimonies. So if I could please have Timothy Tutwiler and William Chapman Clutie and Francis Jackson.
You know, first thing I want to know is why we didn't follow the original order and them come after us, so I ain't had to follow that. Yeah. But I came up here. I'm sort of like my boy Chad, and I don't come up here with a set agenda and everything I'm going to say. But as I seen all these students, the alum and all them coming up here, you know, I got a few ideas. one is, as everybody was coming up here, you saw how good of speakers and everything they were. And that reminded me of my sophomore year. And I'm looking for Eloisa because she was part of a plan with Miss Anita that conspired to get me. Because my freshman year, I wasn't a good speaker. I wouldn't get up in front of all y'all and do this. We would have our little mentor sessions and everything, and I would just say, when it come to me, I had to introduce my name, say where I'm from, and all that stuff. And I just, oh, my God, be through with it right there. But now, you know, what happened was, I was walking through the hall. This is my sophomore year. Eloisa came up to me and she was like, Tut, would you like to be on do this panel diversity series? And she asked me, did I want to be on the panel? I told her, no, but I would come to it and, you know, still ask the students a few questions and stuff like that. And that was like a week before the series was supposed to take place and everything. And I guess during that time they got together. She told Ms. Anita that I was gonna come to that, and she told her exactly what I was gonna do. And Ms. Anita, I don't know, my baby got to be on the panel. So, but the thing wasn't it. What it was is a week took place between that time, and they didn't tell me nothing. So, by the time I got there, you know, I thought I was just gonna eat free lunch because I wasn't on a meal plan. I was staying off campus. And so I got there. It's about 30, 40 faculty, because they like free lunch too. All them was there. And there was these tables. They was all lined up. And my name was on one of the chairs up there facing all them. So, you know, I got nervous. My palms got sweaty. And I couldn't even eat before that. And, you know, since it was a series, this just didn't happen one time. This happened once a month all of the first semester. But, you know, by the time I got to the fourth one, you know, I still wasn't eating before I spoke. But, you know, I felt better about it. And then at that time, it was, you know, the convocation came up and everything. And I was feeling good about myself, you know. Four panel series under my belt, you know, I was used to doing this speaking and everything, so I said, I'll be the MC of the convocation. And, you know, as you know, like the memorial and everything, things didn't go in the correct order, so I was up here struggling, you know. Joe was pointing at me, Bobby Joe, Miss Anita, all of them was pointing at me, oh, no, different thing, this and that, sending notes up to me and everything, but like now, I worked it out, though. Yeah. Oh, one more thing I wanted to say, you know, that's something that, like, spread throughout all of us. And, you know, by the time I'm a senior now, last year, I didn't get to do any public speaking. And this year until now, this was my first time. So, you know, I got to the point where I was offended when they didn't ask me. But one last thing, and I'm going to get down because I know it's getting late and everything. We've been here 2 hours. I remember something Professor Williams was talking about as far as, like, all our relationships and everything. And I remember she got us all one time because normally when we go to all of the sessions and everything, she would always have us say something that we loved about ourselves and everything. But she noticed that, like, when we'd be walking through the halls or just be at our office and everything, we was always talking about each other. So we was going up to one of the sessions. We thought, oh, we just got to say something we love about each other. She had us all circled up and everything. And whoever was beside you, you had to say something you liked about that person. Now, all of us didn't really, you know, like each other and everything like that. But we had to come up with something good. And you might not be sitting next to somebody you wanted to say something good about at that time. So, but we all came up with something, and, you know, that's just how Miss Anita was in trying to, you know, encourage us to have good relationships with each other. That's my time.
Well, I don't think I can top you, so I'll just say what I have to say. I haven't known Anita for a long time. I just got here last year. But she's one of the people in my life that's had an impact on how I think, how I make decisions, and how I help other people. Anita was a very unselfish person. And that's the one thing I remember most about her. She was sick all the time. So, and a lot of times, I didn't even know she was ill. But she always took time to help me. And I'm going to share with you one experience that happened last year that I probably will never forget. It was last year at the end of the year, and I just found out that I had this huge internship, and it was with NASA, and I was extremely nervous about it. I was like, oh, I can't go, it's going to be too tough, I might not do well. And I went to Miss Anita, I said, you know what, I said, I'm Black, plus I have a disability, how in the world am I going to keep up with those guys? And she sent me down, she said, you know what? She says, you got skills. I said, how do you know that? How do you know I got skills? She said, you know what? I know. And so I remember getting on the plane, I got to the office, and, you know, I was really, really nervous. I remember what she told me. She said, you got skills. And I kind of found out I did just fine. With all the testimony that you've heard today, there is no doubt or any question how much she has done. So we only have one thing left to do. And we're pretty much obligated to do it. We have to continue her legacy. You know, if you're not enrolled in Pan-African, you may not realize all the stuff that she has built for us. But it's a lot. And before I graduate from this school, I want to make sure and when I leave, somebody else can come to the door as a freshman and still have the stuff here. She left us a complete toolbox The tools are still here. All we have to do is take them out and use them. Thank you.
Hello. As one of the last student workers for Miss Anita Gay Hawthorne, I had a lot of privileges as far as meeting her daily on a daily basis was concerned. A lot of the things I planned to say have already been said, but I think there are a couple of unique experiences that I had with her that I can still share with you. And as I was upstairs taping and I saw the Excelsior choir come in, the first thought that came to me was how she, Miss Hawthorne, lured me to sing at an occasion in North Minneapolis in front of a whole gathering, which I declined to do that, but she said, you can do it. She said, and then she asked me, what can you do? I said, nothing. You don't write. Then she asked me, do you write poems? I looked at her funny, and she said, why are you looking at me like that? I said, because I'm not a poet. Then she said, can you sing?
No.
And then she said, okay, we're going to find you something to do. And then, so she went over and told, she called Bobby Joe, and I was there while she started talking to him, and I hadn't met Bobby Joe in person before, not knowing Bobby Joe was going to show up that day in the office. And then, so she made sure I was there together with Keith, and then after a while, Bobby Joe showed up and said, oh, you are the brother who's going to be singing the African song, aren't you? And so I looked at him and I said, where is he coming from? But then I had to, I talked to him and he was real nice. So I said, yeah, I was going to do it. But behind my mind, I was like, the day will get by and I'll dodge them or do something. But I gathered courage day after day when we went to practice. We sang together. And I was surprised. And right now, I still don't believe how I was able to get up there on the stage and sing in front of the whole gathering. Because I remember her patting me. She was sitting right behind me in the front pew. I was sitting in the front pew and she was in the second pew. And she kept tapping me. When it was time for me to go up, she said, you can do it. You can do it. So when I got up there, I had forgotten everything. And until I finished singing, I didn't know I was on the stage. And up till today, I don't know how I did that. And one of the memorable occasions too was when she didn't show up for work on a Thursday. And so prior to that, she had given me her number, home number, to call her up anytime and talk. But I wasn't the kind of person who calls like elderly people and talks. Like, I don't know what to talk about. So she said, call me up. So I left the phone number on her desk, pretending I didn't have it. So that would be a good excuse to say, well, I didn't take the number. So the next time she wrote the number twice and handed it to me, and she said, put it in your pocket. I put it down. She said, later, when I'm leaving, I'll take it. She's like, no, put it up there in your pocket. So I put it in my pocket. And so when she didn't show up, this time I called her and I talked to her. And then the next time she didn't show up, she went to the hospital and I didn't call her. And so then the next day I went to work and I was still worried. And I was asking friends if they had like talked to her or seen her. And I felt guilty, and then the next following day she came to work and I couldn't walk into the office because I didn't know what to tell her. And she said, look me in the face. And I said, hello. Then she said, I didn't show up for work, but you didn't even call to see how I was doing. I said, I started murmuring, and she looked at me and said, yeah, you treat me like a stepchild. And so ever since then, she's kind of like instilled into me the importance of returning calls and the essence of showing little but important recognition to people who are around us. And one last thing before I leave here is that I remember in the, we have this mentoring session that we do for all Pan-African students. She gives out people, mentors outside, and she hands them like lists of students and has people mentoring each, every student has a mentor. And so in this program, the last three programs we had were the third to the last was on change, and she wanted to talk about change and have us all well acquainted with the subject, but I think she wasn't as pleased as she wanted to be. The message wasn't carried across as she wanted it to be. So she waited for the last mentoring session, and we went back to change. And this time, I think she got the message across, so she got happy. And then the last thing I would say now is, on the Thursday before, the last day I saw her here at school was on a Thursday, and when she was leaving, she left before the normal time, and said she needed some rest. So she told me when I was about to leave to go tell Cindy, who was next door, she spoke earlier on, that I was leaving. And that was the first time she ever told me that. And because of that, I was wondering if she thought I was going to run away as soon as she left. I was also going to leave and say, punch in and say that I worked the full hours. But coming to think of it, I thought she probably knew that I wasn't going to see her no more, because she hugged me and she said, and then when I left, went back to the office, she walked out and came back in and said bye to Cindy, and then told me, be strong. And that was her last word. Thank you.
I first of all want to thank all of you who came out to share with us this evening for something that has been a lot tougher than I thought it was going to be, except the reality that we have something, as Cisco so appropriately said, we have something to do, something to carry on, something to move forward with. I want to take a moment just to acknowledge the family, Kevin Hawthorne and Mr. and Mrs. Hawthorne. His parents are here. Go ahead and stand up. We want to just recognize you. I heard a Baco say to Kevin earlier, thank you for loving her. And so we definitely do that. We thank you for loving her. Years ago, Anita used to always talk about her son. Now, she called everybody son and everybody daughter, but there was one guy who she always referred to. And he was a little guy last time I remember him. And now he's an adult flying planes all over the place. And I just want to recognize Cedric here. Y'all stand up. This is who. And we also want to recognize Mrs. Josephine Leonard, the mother of Anita Hawthorne. And we definitely. We just want to reinforce the thought that one of our students said earlier, thank you for being mom to our mom. And there's no way that we could have possibly put on any and everyone who probably had something good to say, because we would be here for years, and there's no doubt about that. There's no doubt about the fact that most of everybody who spoke today could have gone on and on. And at the same time, we wanted to make sure we took that time. As a memorial, we wanted to make sure we took the time to hear people whose lives have been impacted. And more than that, that their lives are impacting other lives because of the life that impacted theirs. And so we want to thank all of our speakers and presenters and testifiers, our poets, our singers and musicians. We just want to thank everybody who helped to make this proper. Amen. And if you would stand again, Ms. Leonard, our students wanted to present you with two things. One is a very nice bouquet of flowers. Come on up. And we want to present you with a plaque. This plaque reads, Grandmother Pan-African Award. Mrs. Josephine Leonard, the mother of our mother, thank you for the love we received through the love you gave. Margaret Anita Leonard Gay Hawthorne Memorial Convocation, Monday, May 4th, 1998. As we close, I want to also acknowledge, I don't think she's here at this moment, but Sharon Rolick, who helped William and I put together a little poetic video ending for our program this evening. If you'll turn your attention to the screen, I'm going to turn on the video, and we are going to close out our program in something very reminiscent. In fact, it begins with probably the last poem she read publicly. And and I should acknowledge this, I thank you, President Frame, for being here. She read the same poem at your inauguration that she read last fall at the her Jazz and Poetry Bash. And we will continue what she started here. I was privileged to be here in the interim. I hope to be here on a permanent basis. And we will continue what Anita has planted here and move it forward.
When we are apart from one another, Please know the loneliness I feel. And love me. I'll be loving you.
Thank you. can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. If I just spread my wings, I can fly. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. Oh, I can fly. I can spread my wings like an eagle. I can fly. I can fly. If I can see it, then I can do it. And if I just believe it, there's nothing to it. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. To spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly. Oh, I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you for this day. Father, we ask that everyone in this building would travel safely home, and we thank you for your protection and coverage and everything you've done for us, the spirit you've left us, and the vision you've given us through Anita. And all of these things we thank you and praise you for and glorify you in the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen.